popular music is a place where a lot of people go to find their different pieces of their identity. Who am I? What do I believe in?
In 1972, a 23-year-old Bruce Springsteen was on an elevator in New York wrestling with some insecurities.
I was on the elevator going up to what might have been the 30th floor in Black Rock, which was with my manager, and John Hammond was seeing nobodies who he did not know at all off the streets of New York City, who simply talked their way through his secretary. Mike Appel was very good at that, and he did it. We've got a 30-minute audition with John Hammond. We go up. On the way up, I'm going, well, it's like this. I have nothing. When I come back, I'm not going to have any less than I have right now. So I'm trying to talk myself into not being nervous. It almost worked, but not quite.
Half an hour later, he would be set on a journey that in part would be driven by those insecurities and that would change his life forever.
I only played about 3 songs. And after I played one song, and he said, you got to be on Columbia Records. I said, okay.
Bruce Springsteen was born on September 1949 to a working class family in New Jersey and fell in love with rock and roll after hearing the likes of Elvis Presley and later the Beatles. At 16, he joined his first band, the Castiles, where he started learning his craft and writing his first songs.
Everything I learned musically, I probably learned between 1965 and 1968, between when I was 15 and 18. I was a student, an astute student of Top 40 radio, where the masters of songwriting and record making existed at that moment in time. I studied that like it was for my master's degree. And I would write the lyrics as poetry because I had in my mind that I was that kind of a writer. You depend upon your craft, but there's more to it than craft. You know, there's inspiration, and that's writing for you. You know, you don't know how and what shape and when different pieces of work are going to come along. You write what comes out of you, you know, and that's the best that you have to offer at a given moment. That moment before you take something that is just in the air and suddenly you make it physical. You know, that exact moment is quite indescribable, you know, but when it happens, it's funny because it's such a wonderful thing, you know. But that exact moment is a moment that I've never known or read anyone who's been able to describe it. What happens between that moment of when things are ready to sprout and then when they're there, that's the moment that can't be described. That's why it's magic. There's this long intubation period. It's like a garden, you know. You seed it with experience and time. And then you wait, all right? And you don't know how long you're going to have to wait. Unfortunately, creativity does not work as like the seasons do. You know, if I knew I was going to get a batch of songs every winter, I'd be a lot happier, or every summer. But you seed it, and then eventually something... there's an incident or an event or something in life just sort of sets it off and they come. At that moment, something that is totally not physical, that is simply emotional, spiritual, and in the air becomes physical. It manifests itself as a physical piece of music. And then if you're lucky, you know, you'll catch a metaphor, you'll catch a title, you'll catch a line, and songs start to lead the way. Sometimes I start with music. Sometimes more often you have a line, or you pick the guitar up and you know, you're lucky if you get a title. If you get a good title, you're on your way. If I can write a song and make that title work, I'm good. But sometimes you just pick the guitar up and it comes out of your mouth. I write when the writing is there and when I'm sort of inspired, and I don't worry about not writing. It's simply not predictable, and you have to get used to withstanding that anxiety, and you have to get comfortable with it, because born in the USA, I think I wrote 8 or 9 of those songs, and then and then spent a year waiting for Dancing in the Dark, Bobby Jean, and No Surrender. So in a sense, when I feel like that, and you always feel like that after you've written a good song, you go, oh, I hope that's not the last one, you know, but I've kind of gotten used to that being part of the natural state of a writer's consciousness, even after all the craft that you've learned, that, you know, you just don't know how you do it. And so I know it'll come along at some point. I don't know how or when. So I'm both, I guess the best way to explain it was I'm comfortable with the anxiety. So it's sort of like you start your car and it runs. Oh, great. An album comes out. You start your car, it runs for a half an hour, breaks down, doesn't run for 2 weeks, start it again, nothing, again, nothing. Records are made like that. You know, I've written a song, I've written six songs that I think are really record worthy, and then spent a year trying to write six more. I don't operate from deciding first. I operate from an internal hunger, and my decisions come from there. Anything that starts intellectually usually sucks. I almost always depend on some inner life sending a message to my brain to get active and to employ the mechanics that I've learned over and the craft I've learned over the years. But it always comes out of the heart and soul first. So that's generally the process of my writing. Now, I have one leg being the creator, and I have another one that's the audience. And they're there simultaneously. And if I come up with something that's moving, I think I feel the same response even while I'm creating it, that the audience is going to feel, you know? So you're both creator and audience simultaneously. And partially by being the audience, it's assisting you in judging the quality of what you've done.
A collection of words, melody, rhythm, and harmony only becomes a proper song when it has truth in it. There has to be an emotional truth for us songwriters to connect with the song we're writing. And so an audience can see their own emotional truth reflected back at them.
A pop song is a condensed version of a life in 3 minutes.
Why songs are good is because it's like in art and in love. It's like, hey, one and one makes three. In music, if it makes two, you failed, my friends. You know, if you're painting and all you got is a paint and a canvas, you failed. If all you got your notes and you failed. You've got to find that third thing that is truly coming up from inside of you.
Regret. Love. You know, you have to zero in on the truth of those particular emotions. So every song has a piece of you in it. A spiritual truth, an emotional truth, you have to draw up from inside of your essence.
If you don't reach down and touch that thing, then you're just not going to have anything to say, and it's not going to feel like it has life and breath in it. You're not going to create something real, and it's not going to feel authentic.
Through all of Bruce's influences, when it came to lyrics, there was one artist he took from and learned how to write songs that really said something. Many say there wouldn't be a Bruce Springsteen without Bob Dylan. Bruce was heavily influenced by Bob Dylan, and Dylan was influenced by T.S. Eliot, an American-born British poet who coined the phrase objective correlatives, an artistic and literary technique of representing or evoking a particular emotion by means of symbols. T.S. Eliot described this as a set of objects, a situation, events, or actions that reveals an emotion and is expressed through a sensory experience of them.
The incidences, the details, the story itself can be something, a complete work of imagination. So you have to be able to draw on your own inner truth, but at the same time, you can dress it up in any monkey suit that you want. And I often do. People like stories. And they like stories that connect to their inner geography. Your inner geography may or may not have to do with anything you've experienced or not experienced. It's simply the geography of your emotional life.
That's the writer's job. The writer collects and creates those moments from out of your own experience and the world that you see around you. And then you use your imagination and you put those things together and you present that experience to your audience, who then experience their own inner vitality, their own center, their own questions about their own life and their moral life, their whatever you're writing about, you know, and there's a connection made.
And then you can fill it out in any character and in any circumstance that you want.
Bruce's 1981 classic, The River, is a prime example of how he uses objective correlatives. Not only is the river used to symbolize dreams and hopes of the future, but Bruce creates a situation that provokes the emotion of those hopes and dreams running dry by the song's protagonist getting Mary pregnant and being out of work. He uses the setting, geography and location to give the song's characters a reason for the emotion they feel through the circumstances that produce that emotion. This is a common songwriting technique and not just reserved for the traditional storytelling songs. It can be seen in more contemporary pop songs like Taylor Swift's song Cardigan. The cardigan itself symbolizes the protagonist being reminded of her own self-worth. The line, "High heels on cobblestones," symbolizes a young woman coming of age, stumbling into adulthood, finding her feet on the uneven surface of society. And again, these symbols are expressed through the sensory experience of the objects and the situation. This shows the listener the emotion as opposed to telling them by triggering their sense memories.
Everyone has memories that they carry with them for no explicable reason. And these things, they call, whether you call them sense memories or but they live within you. They are an essential part of who you are. And they may not be connected to any specific event. There was just, you had some moment of pure experience that stayed with you. You know, not where something happened, maybe nothing happened, but it was just, for some reason on that particular day, you had some moment of pure experience that revealed to you what it meant to be alive. What it means to be alive, what the stakes are, the wind on a given day, how important it is, you know, what you can do with your life can be brought back to you by the sound of your feet on gravel at a certain moment, you know. Why do you remember when you were 11 years old and you were walking down a particular street on a certain day and the trees, there was a certain wind blowing through the trees, and the sound your feet made on the stones as you came up the drive, you know, and the way the light hit the particular house. You just try to bring forth experience, you know, and get people in touch with all of those things and in their world, you know.
Writing is largely an act of the imagination, but which is where you get your geography, your detail of character. But for that character and geography to come to life, into a real breathing world, you have got to tap into your own true inner life. So when you're doing both of those things, you're writing well. And you do it really well. It's so credible that people simply believe it's you.
That's the real job. That's the job that keeps you writing. That's what keeps you wanting to write that next song, because you can do that. And because if I do it for you, I'm doing it for me.
On October the 23rd, 2020, Bruce Springsteen released his 20th studio album, Letter to You, becoming the first artist to have a top five album in each of the last six decades. Bruce's journey started in New Jersey and brought him around the world and into the hearts of generations. And it's a journey that is far from over.
Who am I? You're a repairman. And first thing you're trying to do is repair yourself. You know, the places that you've been wounded or hurt or feel empty. And then through doing that, you come up with a gift where you can help people repair themselves through your music. What do I believe in?
I do believe that your doubts and questions and insecurities do move your work forward, do keep you questioning, do keep you searching, and that's at the key of artistic progression.
Life is great joy, great pain. You try to blend them together in a way that makes life bearable to live. You know, so that thing that you've created comes out of that ground. And what makes the joy feel real is the fact that it's embedded in this soil of difficulty and struggle and pain that you've lived through and are trying to make sense out of as a repairman, as a musician.